We thank you, Lord, that even in the rain, Lord Jesus, that you gave us enough good sense to get up and give you glory. We ask now, Lord, bless upon this service. Bless upon everybody who's watching. Bless upon everybody who's listening. We ask now, Lord, that you send your power in this place, that all of us will be changed from your glory. We thank you, Lord, for your blessings. We thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice. We thank you, Lord, for just being who you are. And we ask now, Lord, that you move in our lives. All of us need something from you, Lord. We ask, Lord, that you give it to us right now. We lift up, Lord, the leadership of our country, the leadership of our city and our state. Lord, we ask that you be with them. Allow them, Lord, to make good decisions. Allow them, Lord, to know that you are in control, that you are God. It's in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Amen.
Great fear, the Israelites cried out to the Lord.
They said to Moses, was it because there were no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us, bringing us out of Egypt? Is this not the very thing we told you in Egypt? Let us alone and let us serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness. But Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. Stand firm and see the deliverance that the Lord will accomplish for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you only have to keep still. Then the Lord said to Moses, why do you cry out to me? Tell the Israelites to go forward. But you lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the Israelites may go into the sea on dry land. Then I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, so that they will go after them. And so I will gain glory for myself over Pharaoh and all of his army, his chariots and his chariot drivers. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gained glory for myself over Pharaoh, his chariots, and his chariot drivers. I want to use for a subject, every end is a new beginning. Every end is a new beginning. Even if you're not consistent in your church attendance, and even if you didn't graduate from Sunday school, the backdrop and the condition of Exodus chapter 14 are familiar and known to most of us. So as a reminder, the children of Israel have been in bondage for 438 years. So 438 years of slavery in Egypt, 430 years of building pyramids with limited resources, 430 years of without equal treatment, 430 years of overseers and people above them. So 430 years of slavery. And if slavery wasn't enough, in Exodus chapter 1, we're introduced to a new Pharaoh and a new king and a new ruler in Egypt who's afraid of the slaves, because he understands if these slaves part away the enemies of Egypt, that they'll be caught off and overtaken. So this Pharaoh with an evil mind sends out an email and a text message that all the male children must be killed, because this Pharaoh has found out that if you want to eliminate a people from the earth, that you attack their children. Because here's how you eliminate people from the earth. Because you redevelop and you urbanize neighborhoods and the communities that they live in. And you change the character of the neighborhood through the opening of more wealthy residents and more businesses so they can't afford to live there. You overpopulate their schools and underfund their education. And you label them with ADD by the time they get to the third grade. You raise them in an area where it's hard to buy affordable and good quality fresh food, but there's a fast food restaurant on every corner for them to eat. Then you overpopulate their communities and kill their children, but don't charge the police that take their lives. Then you earn money off of jails and prisons, and you lock up brown and black bodies, and you make it possible for people to make money by sending us to jail. Then you take children of immigrants who don't know anything but America, and you send them back across the border without any help or any family. And that's how you kill the people. And there's a Pharaoh in our land who thinks that this is a very good idea. And as we deal with this administration that has come to Egypt, we hear a couple of words that should change our outlooks. And those words are but God. And I wish I had somebody early in this sermon who knows the power of but God. Because the Lord has organized the deliverance of his people. And the Lord is going to liberate them from the hand of Pharaoh and all the sinners around a brother named Moses. And Moses is rare, because Moses is bicultural. Because Moses is born Hebrew, but he's raised Egyptian. So Moses has a heart for his people, but he speaks Pharaoh's language. So Moses has a right to use the palace, and he can go in and out without being stopped. And the Lord declares that if I'm going to deliver my people, that I just don't need a movement, but I need somebody who has some access to Pharaoh. And I need a man just like Moses. So the Lord meets Moses in chapter 3 in an experience through a burning bush. And he tells Moses, I've seen the oppression of my people, and I've heard their cries. And Moses is sent back to tell Pharaoh one message. And Moses goes back to tell Pharaoh that God told me to tell you to let my people go. But Pharaoh didn't move by Moses. And Pharaoh doesn't care anything about what Moses is saying. And Pharaoh refuses to release the slaves. So God, through Moses, authorizes 10 plagues in Egypt. And the purpose of the plagues was to assure that Pharaoh and that the Israelites knew that God was with Moses. So Moses is used by the Lord to introduce plague after plague after plague. So everybody who looked at Moses would know that the hand of God was on him. But 9 plagues don't move Pharaoh. And it's only the 10th plague when the death angel sweeps through Egypt. When the Pharaoh who wanted to kill Israelite children has the same death authorized on his family, that he decides to move. Because Pharaoh doesn't change until it happens to his children. Because Pharaoh doesn't mind deporting your children. Pharaoh doesn't mind sending your children back to school in the middle of a plague. Pharaoh doesn't mind saying that your child is almost immune to a plague. But as soon as Pharaoh catches a plague, that's when the precautions are being taken to ensure that children are kept safe and healthy. So Pharaoh is moved by the 10th plague. And in chapter 12, around verse 31, he briefly dismantled slavery. And he summoned Moses and Aaron at night. And he says, y'all ain't got to go home, but y'all got to get up out of here. And the Bible says that about 600,000 men, besides women and children, follow Moses out of Egypt. And what the Bible really says in Exodus chapter 12, verse 38, is that it was 600,000 men besides women and children. And a mixed crowd also went up with them. So now I need us to know that the Hebrews and the Israelites are not the same. Because the Israelites were a part of the Hebrews, but the Hebrews are also included in a mixed crowd. So when the Lord opens the door of deliverance, it's not just the Israelites that he leads out, but it's also a mixed crowd and a diverse group. Because the hand of God doesn't disfavor one group of people, but the hand of God operates to deliver and liberate all those who are oppressed, all those who are kept down, all those who are burdened, all those who are hungry, all those who are weighed down. Because the Lord doesn't just deliver y'all, but God delivers all. And let me tell y'all, and that's a good word, because a sad group of people who only want the Lord to deliver you while you still caught up in the oppression of other people. Because how can oppressed people want to oppress other people? Because don't you know that the God that brings us out is the God that brings all out. And the Lord doesn't discriminate in who he uses and who he delivers, because the Lord delivers all of his children. Because the Lord is not either or, but the Lord is both and. And that's both race and gender, both culture and identity, both education and income. And we can't come between the hand of God when it comes to delivering his people. So with 600,000 men, not including women and children, and a mixed crowd, that could mean that more than 1 million people follow Moses out of Egypt. So 1 million people are following one man. And 1 million people are following one man because they believe that Moses is following God. So 1 million people believe that this man is listening to God and obeying God. And 1 million people are following Moses because they believe that Moses is following and abiding in God. So please don't miss this, because they look at Moses and they believe that God is with him. God is leading him. God's hand is on him. And we're going to follow him because the Lord has him. And everything is everything at the start of chapter 14. But by the time we get to verse 10, all hell is breaking loose. Because by the time we get to verse 10, 2 problems have come up. Because on their way out of following Moses, they hear the sound of chariots. And they turn around and they see Pharaoh and all of his army are now chasing the Hebrews, and that Pharaoh has changed his mind. So he must have called a meeting in the west wing of the palace and had a meeting with the Council of Economic Advisors. And they must have told him that we can't build this nation without free labor, because this nation has been built on the free labor of the enslavement and suppression. He must have had a meeting with the Office of Management and Budget, and somebody must have reminded him that without slaves, there will be no Egyptian privilege. So we have to reclaim these slaves so we can feel better about ourselves and think that we're better than everybody else, because we have to keep our advantage, and they're chasing after the Hebrews. So 1 million people on foot are being chased by an army of people on chariots. And somebody realizes that this ain't gonna go well. But y'all, the bigger problem is not what's behind it, But the bigger problem is what's in front of them. Because they follow Moses, they hear the chariots, and they look in front of them, and they have ran up on the shore of the Red Sea. And we know how this story ends, but that's not how it begins. Because they get to the Red Sea, and ain't no path in the middle. Ain't no bridge over troubled water. Ain't no wade in the water. Ain't no boats waiting to take them to the other side. And a million people have followed Moses, chariots behind, a hard place in front. And they do what church don't know how to do. And they start to complain. And listen to what they say to Moses in verses 11 and 12. Didn't we tell you to leave us alone in Egypt? But no, you had to bring us all the way out here, in the middle of the wilderness. Pharaoh is behind us. We don't have anywhere else to go. And you done messed up. But notice that there's no talk about the Lord in this. Because they don't say that the Lord brought us out here. But they say, Moses, this is your fault. Because they being struck between the heart, a rock and a hard place, has caused them to doubt what the Lord is going to do. Because if Moses was following God, this Red Sea wouldn't be here. If Moses heard God right, this wouldn't be happening. We followed you in good faith, because you said God was leading you. And now we're struck between a rock and a hard place. Is there nothing for us to do? Pharaoh is about to kill us. We don't have anywhere to go. So Moses, you can't be following God. Because if you were following the Lord, this wouldn't be happening. Now I want us to put ourselves in Moses' sandals this morning. Because Pharaoh was behind him, complaining church folk on both sides of him, and a Red Sea in front of him. So the enemy is in the back. Naysayers and doubters all around him, and a hard place in front of him. And here's the problem that Moses is facing. Because how do I understand with this situation that the Lord has me in? Because is the Red Sea the start, or is the Red Sea the end? Because I've been following God, and now I have to deal with a situation that I don't know if the Lord is trying to stop me, or if the Lord is trying to tell me to stretch my faith and to keep going. Because this is what happens when you walk with God. Because we come up on situations, and we don't know how to discern if the Lord is trying to stop us, or if the Lord is telling us that we need to stretch our faith and push through this thing. And is this situation the end, or is this situation the beginning? And y'all, what makes this hard for me is that the Lord uses both. Because the God that I serve are closing in some situations for you. Because when he sees us moving in directions that's not according to his will, and when we're going after something that God doesn't want us to have, and when the Lord wants to protect us from our own desires, the Lord is able to end the situation that you can't do nothing about. And I wish I had a witness this morning who knows that the Lord can shut down some stuff. God can close some doors. God knows how to tell you no. The Lord knows how to make it possible for you to go in that direction. Is there anybody other than me this morning who's ever experienced the Lord shut you down? And let me tell you how you know the grown folk. Because the grown folk that experienced God shut them down. But they can look back now rather than get mad at God. They can give God a hallelujah and a thank you, Jesus. Because I thank you that you shut it down. Thank God that I didn't get what I wanted. Thank God that I didn't marry him. Thank God that I didn't get that job. And I thank God for shutting some stuff down. But y'all, not only will the Lord use situations to end, but the Lord will also use some situations to begin. Because every journey with the Lord is not easy and stress-free. Because when we're faithful to God, the Lord will put some Red Seas on our journey to teach us how to get through. God will put some mountains in our way to teach us how to climb. God will put some haters of enemies in our ears to teach us how to ignore some people. God will put some problems in our way to teach us how to pray. Because the Lord will use our Red Seas to grow us. And sometimes when we come up on the Red Sea, it's just a reminder that now is not quitting time. But now is the time for you to put your big girl pants on and to holler like Jacob that I won't let go until you bless me. And I'm going to pray my way through. I'm going to push my way through. I'm going to fight my way through. Because sometimes that Red Seas are not the end, but they are the beginning. But how do you know the difference? And how do you know that the situation that I'm in, is the Lord telling me that what I'm going through is the wrong decision? Or is it the Lord telling me to push through? So how do I know the difference between the beginning and the end? Because that rejection letter that I got, is that the Lord telling me that I should stay on the job that I had? Or should I apply somewhere else? that disappointment that I'm dealing with, is that the Lord telling me that it's not his will? Or is the Lord telling me to exercise my faith? That trouble in the relationship, is that the Lord telling me that they're not the one? Or is that God telling me to bring all my problems to the altar? Because the people that were with Moses saw the Red Sea as the end. Because they didn't think that the way that the Lord wanted them to go. But Moses saw it as the beginning and an opportunity to exercise their faith. But how does Moses see it as the beginning when the people saw it as the end? So how do we know the difference between the beginning and the end? And y'all, the answer in that comes in another question. And it's a question that only you can answer for yourself. Because the difference between the beginning and the end is this. How did you get the way you are? Because here's how Moses knew that it was the beginning and not the end. Because Moses knew that he didn't get there because of what he wanted. Because I didn't just wake up and say, follow me and let's bounce. But when we left Egypt, there was a pillar of cloud leading us. And y'all didn't know it was a hand of God then. But we were following what I knew was a hand of God. So I just get here and pray. But I prayed my way here. And I just didn't get here and start talking to the Lord. But I've been talking to the Lord all the way here. Because by the time we get to chapter 14, Moses had been talking to God since chapter 3. Because in chapter 3, the Lord spoke to me and I heard. In chapter 4, I obeyed God and I went to Pharaoh, even if I didn't want to go. In chapter 5, I told the Lord and it didn't work. But in chapter 6, the Lord told me to keep on doing the doggone thing. In chapter 7, I told God that I needed some help, and he sent Aaron. So I obeyed in chapter 8. I surrendered in chapter 9. I walked with God in chapter 10. I was obedient in chapter 12. And by the time that I got here, I had already prayed my way here. So I know that it's not the end, because I didn't get here because of what I wanted. But I got here because of what I prayed for and what God willed for me. And y'all, the ability to understand whether you're dealing with the beginning or the end is how much you prayer you have behind you. And can you say that you prayed your way to this situation? Because if truth be told, most of the Red Seas that we face, we got here following what we want. So let me tell you about you for just a minute. Because every Red Sea that you face, the Lord didn't lead you there. And for the people that they saw the end, because they didn't have the prayer life that Moses had. And they haven't talked to God. They haven't surrendered to God. And if you and the Lord don't have a history of struggling with some stuff, when you lay it out before the Lord, and you let the God know a few things, and when you pray day in and day out, because there's no prayer, it's the end. Because you haven't talked to the Lord about it. That heartache, God is saying no. That rejection letter is God saying it's not my will. But if you like Moses this morning, and you've been talking to the Lord about it, if you struggle with God, and you surrender what God was telling you to do, if you wore your mattress out, praying in, praying day in and day out, if you have a prayer cloth that you meet God in every day, if your oil has ran out from anointing yourself every day, if you have a prayer partner on speed now that you call so much that they block you and won't take your call, and if you pray like that, then what you're facing is not the end. But what you're facing is the Lord giving you a chance to exercise your faith and for him to show you his glory. And if you know that prayer has led you where you are, and you believe that every end has a new beginning, then hear what Moses says in verse 13. Don't be afraid. Stand firm and see the deliverance that God will accomplish. And y'all, that directive, stand firm, that Moses gives us, it means to stand up or to offer resistance to something or somebody. It means to refuse to abandon your opinion or your belief. It means to present yourself to the Lord and let God work it out. Because when we're in our Red Sea moments and we don't know what to do, we can't ever pray to God and God won't do anything. Because there will never be a time when we need God and we stand firm and the Lord do nothing. Because if we present ourselves to God, and the Lord will do something. So watch the text. Because Moses says that if you stand firm and present yourself to the Lord, that you don't have to be afraid of the Pharaohs in your life. Because in their minds, they made it a wrong decision. And we came up on the Red Sea. Pharaoh is coming. And this is going to be an expensive mistake. Because we made a wrong decision. And it's going to cost us everything. So the people see Pharaoh. And they believe that the decision to follow Moses is going to cost them their lives. But here's what got me. Because the Lord had already told Moses in verse 4 that he was going to harden Pharaoh's heart, and that Pharaoh was going to pursue them on their way out. So the Lord had already told Moses that I'm going to lead y'all out of Egypt, but don't trip when you see Pharaoh come, because I'm going to change Pharaoh's mind. So when the people heard Pharaoh, they thought Moses was wrong. But when Moses heard Pharaoh, he knew God was right. So Moses says, don't be afraid, because the Lord already ordained this to happen. And even if you think that we made a mistake, God will fight your battles. And even if it's a wrong decision, it won't cost you anything. Because if you present yourself to God, even if you make a bad decision, it won't cost you everything. So even if we lay it all on the line, God, and do what God wants us to do, and obey God and make a wrong decision, it won't cost us everything. So if we choose the wrong job, don't be afraid, because you won't be on it long anyway. If you say yes to the wrong man, don't be afraid, because it won't make it to the altar anyway. Because if we stand firm and present ourselves to God, God will protect us from the consequences of our wrong decisions. So don't be afraid. Stand firm and present yourself to the Lord. Then he says, and see the deliverance of the Lord. And y'all, that means to sit back and to watch God be God. Now here's what blessed me. Because nowhere in God's conversation with Moses did the Lord say anything about the Red Sea. So the Lord never told him that the Red Sea would be an obstacle, which means that the Lord didn't tell him that a way would be made in the Red Sea. So when Moses gets to the Red Sea, he has no idea what God is going to do. He doesn't know what the Lord is going to do. He doesn't know how God is going to do it. But this is what he tells the children of Israel that I want to pass on to you. Because if you trust in God and put it all in his hands, the Lord will make a way somehow. And God will make a way somehow. And y'all, I don't know how he's going to do it, but I know he will. I don't know when he's going to do it, but I know he will. But the Lord will make a way somehow. When beneath the cross I bow, he will take away Esau. Let him have your burdens now. When the Lord bears down so heavy, the weight is shown upon your brow. There's a sweet relief in knowing that God will make a way somehow. God bless you.